Good afternoon. I welcome you to this talk. I apologize beforehand. It's going to be in English. It's mainly for the video. But as you noticed, at least some of you, I actually speak Czech. So if you have any questions, you can ask in Czech. I'm going to repeat in English. And this is not a religious event, so you can interrupt me anytime. I prepared this talk about dynamic analysis in practice. Oh, for a moment I was worried. So let's delve into it because we have only like 50 minutes. So first something about who I am. I'm a developer working on FRET, Domain Registration System at CZNIC. FRET is Free Registry for Enum and Domains. And the entire backend is written in C++, so I'm mainly a C++ developer, but I do C as well. Prior that, I worked briefly for AVG on a multi-platform C++ library. And before that, I was quite engineer at Red Hat, where I worked on toolchain. I was testing stuff like compilers, debuggers, and by the way, Walgreens. Valgrind, that's the proper pronunciation, actually, but I will get into it. Okay, so with that introduction out of the way, let's go to what is actually dynamic analysis. Dynamic analysis simply means that the analysis happens at runtime. You can also have analysis at compile time, which is static. And that's not the only distinction. You can actually make other distinctions, like whether you actually instrument the binary or whether you instrument the source code. Obviously, instrumenting source code is a bit error prone. And so, as a programmer, I hate to do that, especially since most programs are actually not written by scratch, right? You are hired to work on something, and it was written like 12 years ago, and you won't go back and like annotate everything with some annotations. So there are, of course, tools like SPLint that use source annotations, but I don't use them, and I've never used them, and I don't know if any of you use them. You can raise your hands, but at this talk, I'm gonna be talking about binary dynamic analysis only, and this is represented mainly by Valgrind and sanitizers. So how it works roughly, some of you may already know, but Valgrind, basically, it's an emulator. That's one way to put it. What it does is basically takes the binary, it decompiles it to some intermediate representation, annotates it, and with some checks and other stuff, and then compiles it again, and then runs it. It's basically the backend is like JIT. It's just in-time compiler. It will compile the new code into some buffer and jumps to the buffer and starts executing. So basically, the program that is running under Valgrind is actually a different program than the one that compiler spits. Sanitizers, they work a bit differently. They're actually part of the compiler. They have usually two parts. You know, there is this. I guess it's wrong to call it optimization pass because it doesn't do optimization, but it's basically pass in the compiler that does instrumentation. Because compiler is basically this huge pipeline. You know, you got IST from front end and you have passes, and then you spit something at the end. That's one part of sanitizers, and the other part is usually some runtime library that contains some functionality that is needed actually at runtime, because error detection doesn't happen at compile time, it happens at runtime. So this is how what was the difference between sanitizers. I decided to include a section about the history a bit, because there were multiple attempts at doing dynamic analysis, and I include some tools. Some of you may know. Some of them are a bit obsolete. Some of them are still in use. This is, of course, not comprehensive. There are many more tools. Is there somebody who remembers electric fans, by the way? You can raise your hands. Nobody. So I'm going to skip it. It was basically something. It was a library that implemented malloc, reloc, and those functions. And basically, for every allocations, it allocated two pages. And it either put the buffer you were allocating at the end of the first page and marked the following page like not accessible. So when you do overrun, you actually cause seg fault. And so that you could detect only overruns or underruns. So by default, you have overruns. And if you set some environment variable, you could detect only underruns. So it allocated two pages. First one was inaccessible, and the other one was at the beginning of the other one was the buffer that you asked for. But this tool is actually still in use. But the main problem is that two pages, like 8 kilobytes usually for a single allocation, it was unusable. Another interesting tool was Matplotlib, or I don't actually know how to pronounce that, but it was part of GCC for like, 9 years. It was removed in 2013. And it was like the first sanitizer. It had like compiler part and library part, but it had one huge problem. It had a lot of false positives. I used it only once. Then there are tools like commercial, like Purify and PIN, or I don't know how to pronounce that either. But Purify is by IBM, PIN is by Intel. PIN has, I think, the advantage that it's running on Windows also, maybe Purify also, I don't know. But this is what people generally use. But this is not what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about mainly Valgrind and sanitizers as implemented in GCC and Clang compilers. So you may ask, why not do just static analysis? I kind of hate static analysis. The reason is simple. It has way too many false positives, usually. There's nothing worse than receiving a list of possible errors. Some of you may know Caverity or Clang Static Analyzer. But the main problem is most of them are false positives. And you waste a lot of time by going through the entire list and trying to figure out what is going on. So the main advantage of dynamic analysis, of doing analysis at runtime, is that you have most of the time, there are still some false positives, but most of the times you have like real bugs with real reproducers. Like every report is a real bug, and that is awesome. Of course, you need some test coverage because you need to run it. You need to run the binary. Now I'm gonna go through types of errors which you can possibly detect these tools. Errors with memory. Everybody knows like leaks, but generally speaking, leaks are kind of errors, not errors. If you are writing some daemon or some library, then you may care about leaks. But if you are writing some command line utility that runs on Linux, and it only spits something on command line and then it ends, then maybe you don't care about leaks. Also, there are like programming techniques that you allocate something from some pool and you don't deallocate, and then you like release the entire pool. So because actually releasing memory is also like CPU intensive task. If you keep releasing something, it may add up. other types of out-of-bound access, obviously you have some buffer and you write before or after that. Use after free, like you do double free. Call free again or delete again, whatever. Use after return, you have something on the stack and your return pointed to it. Uninitialized memory, you have some variable or some buffer and you like read the values without initializing it, and then you use it for some purpose, like you pass it to some syscall or you do some if-else on it. Because actually, uninitialized memory by itself, it's not bad. If you have, like in C and C++, you have struct, you have alignment, and you have some padding, right? You have, for example, if you have struct of long and car, or char, then I don't know, on Intel, this long will be on 64 bits, 8 bytes, and char will be 1, but there will be like 7 bytes of padding, I think. I'm not entirely sure, but there will be some padding, and it will contain some garbage. And it's illegal actually to copy this garbage when the program runs. You know, it's only bad when it changes some observable behavior of the program. Out of these memory errors, like first four are detected by address sanitizer, the last one by memory sanitizer. And all except for use after return are detected by Walgreen's memcheck. But I'm going to talk about those tools later. I have another slide on leaks. This is, you know, I'm mainly a C++ programmer, but of course I sometimes have to go through C code, and to be honest, I don't like it. These two like snippets, they represent, first one is obviously C. That's I try to like illustrate some. There are many ways how to handle memory, right? But this is one of the idiomatic ways. You basically have some function, you allocate something, and if error happens, you just jump at the end and then you release things. You know, because when you have like long functions, it has many, many paths. Usually only one or few are successful. The other ones are error paths. So you jump at error, you release it. And it's I spend a lot of time with static analysis and going through all the coverage reports, and it was really painful. You know? I certainly like the bottom snippet, you know, C++, when you have this idiom called RAII, resource allocation is initialization. It's a stupid name, like it doesn't say anything, but the gist is that you are basically, you have constructor and you have destructor, and you allocate a resource when you are constructing object, and you are releasing it when you destructing object when the destructor is called, and it is called at the end of the block. So at the last like brace, the foo object is destructed, and memory, or it can be any other resource, right? It can be mutex or it can be file, is released, and you don't have to care. Even if you throw an exception, it doesn't matter. It's released and it's guaranteed by the runtime and by the compiler. Any questions to this or no? This is kind of, I had to show you this. I recently found out that you can actually have RAII in C also. You know, if you are happy to use some non-standard extensions, this is supported by both GCC and Clang. You know, you basically use this attribute which you annotate the variable, the type, and when the variable goes out of scope, the release function is called. You know? So that way you can actually have something like RAII in C as well, but it's not standard. You know? It was just for maybe amusement or whatever, if you find it interesting. There's some programmers think that like leaks and all these memory errors that it cannot happen in C++, but of course it can happen in C++. You can have every one of those errors in C++ as well. For example, we have in C++ we have this std share pointer, and that's basically a ref-counted pointer. So we have reference counting, and you can easily create a cycle. You know? And then it's like impossible to get those counts to zero. It's like if somebody used to write code in Perl, that used to be the thing, that it used only ref counting, and when you created a cycle, it leaked. So you can certainly create this in C++. C++ in standard library, there's this weak pointer that should be used to break the cycle. It's like non-owning pointer. Another smart pointer, unique pointer, it has these methods like member functions, get and release. And the difference is that the smart pointer is managing some resources. It has some pointer. And you can either get this pointer via get, or you can get this pointer and release it from the management, smart pointer management, by release. But if you get this wrong, you can do some double free when you release it, and then you release it again. You know? I saw this happen in real code. Also, in C++, you know, when you construct an object and you do not assign it somewhere, you create a temporary, and that is actually destructed at the end of the full expression at some semicolon. But you can actually bound it to reference, const reference. But you cannot bind it to regular reference, only const reference. And I saw some complicated code with lambdas that actually we thought that the temporary was bind to some reference, but it actually wasn't. You know, and Valgren cannot detect these things. I'm gonna go to it because it detects usually these things only on a heap, and not on stack. So I think other sanitizer or memory sanitizer found it. But anyway, you can also have multi-threaded errors like data races. These days, like modern standards, C++ 11, and I'm not entirely sure. You know, I'm not C programmer, but C11, I think also it contains threads directly in the standards. Previously, the threading was done kind of extra, and it wasn't part of the standard. But nowadays, data races are actually undefined behavior, so that's one extra reason why we should avoid them. You can have also deadlocks, lock contention when you are holding lock too long. But I will skip this. You have other kinds of undefined behavior. You can see here basically, these are undefined behaviors that are detectable by these tools, but they are not detectable by other sanitizer or memory sanitizer, because you have four sanitizers. You have other sanitizer, memory sanitizer, leak sanitizer, and undefined behavior sanitizer. And that undefined behavior sanitizer can basically detect these errors. And these are the errors not detectable by other sanitizers. So this is like kind of catch all sanitizer. This is related to last thing. Do you know what VLA is? Variable length array. It's this thing in C99 and C11. This thing I don't really like because it's basically it's like alloca. If somebody knows what alloca is. It's the way to allocate memory on the stack. You basically on Intel you just subtract from stack pointer. And traditionally in C and C++, the size of the array it should be like compile time constant. But in this case, VLA actually allows some runtime number to be size of the array. And the point is, you don't know where the size is coming from, so you can easily like do Stack Overflow. And the problem with this, it's kind of hard to detect, because you detect Stack Overflow by writing somewhere you shouldn't. You don't detect it by allocating this array, because you only subtract a stack pointer, and you don't know it's going past the end of the stack. You know? So you detect it by getting segfault. For example, in C++, we have this thing. It's not part of the standard, but there are multiple libraries that are implementing this. It's called a small vector, and it's a very nice thing. It's basically like std vector. It's dynamic, like dynamic array, but it has some. It's templated on some size, which you can choose. This is a Foley library that's used at Facebook, but it's part of Boost as well, something like that. When I worked at AVG, we had this too in our own library. Basically, what it does, it's a struct that contains like buffer of the size you specify. So this object lives on the stack, function foo, and it has this buffer of 1024 chars. And if you store in it up to that limit, then it's still on the stack, so it's pretty fast, right? But only if you push something more, it's relocated and it's now on the heap. So the nice thing about this is you can have a fast stack allocation. But if you get some huge input, it's gonna go on the heap. So you don't pay what you don't use for. You don't use heap unless you have something really big. And I really like this technique. Maybe it could be emulated somehow in C as well, but in C++, it's really nice to have this. There's other funny stuff with VLA, which I'd like to share. Some of you may know what alloca is. It's a function that does something similar. It basically it's translates to some macro, and it's also like the subtext from stack pointer allocates memory on the stack. But the memory allocated by alloca, it should be destroyed or released at the end of the function, whereas the memory allocated by variable length array should be released at the end of the block. But it cannot always happen, because if you have inside some block that ends before the function and you allocate something with VLA and then you allocate something with alloca, then actually VLA should be destroyed at the end or released at the end of the block, but it cannot be, because memory allocated by alloca is still valid, so it has to wait till the function ends. You know? So it's a mess. I don't know why anybody would use those things in the same place, but it actually happens. You know. There was another thing I wanted to say about VLA. Actually, it's kind of hard to detect, because when your program runs at runtime, Valgrind actually your program may have multiple stacks. You know, for some signal handling, or if you have multiple threads, each thread has its own stack. And you will be switching between the stacks, or at least the program will be switching between the stacks. And Valgrind cannot. There was some attempt to implement some detection. I don't know whether it was successful, but the last time I checked, Valgrind, for example, couldn't detect this, because it couldn't detect whether you are actually having stack overflow or whether you are actually switching the stacks. But the sanitizers. I think other sanitizers actually can detect if you are having VLA with negative size, which I think it's the only way this could happen, I guess, if you have some malicious attack, you know, because I don't see, or maybe some weird error. Yeah. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, it can happen not only by malicious code. You are right, but. Yeah, but both GCC and Clang Sanitizer actually can catch it. Okay, so that was VLA. I have another interesting thing, which is detectable by MemCheck only. I don't think sanitizers can actually detect this. That's more related to C, because the restrict keyword, for example, is not in C++, but maybe as an extension it is, because compiler actually support this for C. Many actually these like questionable features of C language are actually silently supported in C++, because you have the same compiler, and maybe you get some warning, but you may end up using some C feature in C++ without even knowing. It happened to me a few times. So what actually happens if you are... who is C programmer in here? Only two? Yeah, so maybe you know what's the difference between memcopy and memmove. Yeah, because I'm not going to ask you. It's basically memmove. You are like copying some memory from one place to another. But with memmove, the buffers can overlap. And you are still some guarantee that the end of buffer will be, the right thing will be at the other buffer. Destination buffer. But with memcopy, you don't have this guarantee. You know, the buffer must not overlap. And if you, as a programmer, like don't write the code to hold this true, then it may work, or it may you might have silently corrupted the destination buffer, whatever. And this is kind of related to a restrict keyword, which is part of C language. And anybody heard about this restrict keyword? Yeah, it happens when you have like a function, and you have like multiple pointers. You can mark those pointers as restrict, and it's basically a guarantee. Like as a programmer, you can still screw it up, but you are basically telling compiler these pointers, they may never point to the same memory. No, because if you imagine what's happening on the assembly level, you may have some loop, and you are loading something through pointer A. You have two pointers, A, B, and you are loading something through pointer A, and you cache it in register, and then you write something through pointer B. Now you are again loading something through pointer A. And if it's already in a register, you don't have to. But if those two pointers can point to the same memory, you don't know, compiler must be like pessimistic and must think that write through pointer B may have like changed the value previously loaded through pointer A. So it must load stuff through pointer A again. But if those pointers can never point to the same memory, it doesn't have to do that, right? It can still use value stored in the register. So in some tight loops, it might save really performance. So this restrict keyword is basically for yeah.
Is it a standard keyword or is it an extension of compilers?
It's in C. It's standard. In C++, it might be an extension because restrict is on C++, but in C, it's part of the standard. I don't know which one, maybe C99 or whatever. C99. Yeah, thank you. So there are some functions in standard library, like memcopy is one of them. I don't remember them all, like setter copy, setter ncopy. There are like plenty of them. And they have this promise that those buffer cannot overlap. And the arguments, the pointers, are actually marked as restrict. You know, this is something that's like tough to find. Actually, memcheck, Valgrind, that's the main Valgrind tool. I'm going to talk about Valgrind later. It doesn't like detect restrict. It cannot possibly, because only compiler knows it. And by the time you use Valgrind, this information is lost pretty much. But it like knows functions from a standard library which ones are actually using this. For example, it knows there's like memcopy and the buffer shouldn't overlap. So memcheck has its own wrapper it has own its own implementation of, for example, memcopy and other functions, and it can detect these errors if the buffer overlaps. There are some other tool like memstomp. I'm sorry, which is like a library. Which you can preload into your program, and it actually contains implementation of all those standard functions which have this problem. And it can also detect it basically for cheap. So if you suspect that you have this problem, you can either use memstomp or Valgrind. But memstomp, in this specific case, is so much faster because it just implements those functions. Okay, so let's skip to Valgrind. I have this note here that English speakers tend to get the name wrong. They say it's a Valgrind, like as if you are grinding some values. But actually, the name comes from Norse mythology. It was some kind of gate that stood in Valhalla through which some fallen warriors had to pass. And that's the name of this tool. And you should use some Icelandic pronunciation. So if we, in Czech Republic, we say Valgrind, we are basically saying it correct. I just wanted to point it out. Valgrind, it's not only one tool. It's basically a framework for creating like a dynamic analysis tools. You can create your own one, but it's not easy, but in theory you can. You can use all the existing infrastructure because Valgrind is separated to core, which provides all this the compilation, and you just do the instrumentation in the tool. And there are multiple tools. I'm not gonna name them all. I'm gonna name just the three ones which you see on the slide. The main tool is memcheck. That's what you get when you don't specify which tool you want. It's this memory error detector. There are other ones like DRDL Helgrind, which are useful for detecting like multi-threading errors. I personally use them mainly for data races, but because this is main problem for my use case usually. Because I don't do any heavy multi-threading, but it can detect some misuses of POSIX thread API. It can detect some lock contentions and other stuff. So if you don't use it, I recommend it. Okay, now I'm gonna go to other sanitizer. This is a tool that is implemented in both GCC and Clang. And it's basically doing like half of the work that memcheck does, only faster, because it uses this compile time instrumentation, so it doesn't actually emulate anything. It can detect the errors you see. It can detect out-of-bound access, like if you have underrun, overrun. But unlike memcheck, it can detect them on stack and global objects. I have an typo here. It can detect them not only on the heap, but also on the stack or global objects. This out-of-bound access actually happens or is detected by putting some areas, which are called red zones, around the allocated block. Unlike this electric fence, which I mentioned earlier, this is not the whole page, but this is usually a few bytes. I don't know what other sanitizer is using, but for example, Valgrind's memcheck is using 16 bytes by default. So you have 16 bytes marked as you shouldn't touch it. And then you have your memory, and then you have another 16 bytes. But this is easy at runtime. It's easy to do for heap, but it's kind of difficult to use for stack or global objects. So Valgrind doesn't do that. At least memcheck doesn't do that. There's some experimental tool that does that, but it sort of does not work pretty much. But other sanitizer can detect these things on stack for stack and global objects as well, which is kind of nice. Plus, it's faster. It can also detect use after free. That Valgrind can also detect. It's basically you do double free. It does that by like postponing reusing of memory blocks. If for example when you allocate through some memory through malloc, for example, or new, standard library tends to reuse the last block, but this is a bad idea because usually this double free happens like in short time, and if the block is already reused, then you don't detect it. So it actually both Address Sanitizer and Valgrind put the memory blocks to some quarantine, and it tried to postpone its reuse. It's Address Sanitizer. It's like 2 times slower than the native code. So, like Valgrind, it's 40 times. It depends. It's a lot because it does the entire decompilation, compilation. Address Sanitizer. You need to recompile it, but then it's fast. I've on the slide that compiler is actually responsible for putting red zones around stack objects and global objects, and this runtime library is using it for the heap, just like Valgrind does. So this is Address Sanitizer. It's kind of nice. Another nice feature. Last time I checked it worked for me for Clang, but it didn't work for GCC. But in some documentation I've read, it should work for GCC implementation as well. It's actually ODR violation. You have these, at least in C++, I'm pretty sure it's in C as well, but I'm getting confused with all those standards. ODR is like one definition rule. It's basically, some of you may know it if you are C or C++ programmers, is basically you can declare stuff multiple times, but there should be only one definition for everything. There are some minor exceptions for templates, but let's ignore that. If you are compiling one thing and you have definition there, and if you are compiling another thing and you have the same definition there, then linker doesn't care. It doesn't detect these errors most of the time. So it just picks some random thing. And if you have like function foo that does something and another function foo that does something completely different, what happens at runtime? Some completely the other function foo could be called, So and it's not detect. It cannot be detected by the compiler, and it's usually not detected by the linker. So C++ standard says it's undefined behavior. You should have only one definition. It's a programmer's responsibility. But for example, Address Sanitizer has some detection of these violations. So if you run your program, I don't know how this magic happens, but at least for the simple case, I tried, it worked. So if you compile your program with Address Sanitizer, at least the Clang version, and you set this environment variable, it could detect ODR violation if you have like multiple definition of say some function or a variable. It's like nice feature. I was surprised it can do that. Another thing is Leak Sanitizer. It also does part of the work Memcheck usually does. It just detect leaks, and it's by default it's on when you use Address Sanitizer. When you compile with fsanitize address, the Leak Sanitizer is on by default. But if you don't want to pay the price of using Address Sanitizer and you want to use, less memory and you want your program to be faster and you want to detect leaks, you can switch it on like separately. Another thing is Memory Sanitizer. This is also doing a part of the job Memcheck is doing, only faster. And it's for detecting uninitialized memory. It's when you get some memory or some variable, you forgot to initialize it, and then you read the value and use it for something. It changes observable behavior of the program. You do some if or you pass it to some syscall. It's doing it is by shadowing basically memory for each bit of memory. You have some shadow bit, and that tracks whether the memory is initialized or not. So. As I said earlier, in C and C++, it's completely valid to have uninitialized memory or to copy it around. When you copy entire structure, you copy like uninitialized memory. It's okay as long as you don't use it in a bad way. As long as it doesn't change like some kind of observable behavior. Memory Sanitizer has one big problem, at least in my opinion, because You need to recompile basically everything you are using, every library. Otherwise, you have a terrible number of false positives, which is something you don't want. So, you know, all these sanitizers, they were developed at Google, and I suspect that at Google they have no problem like handling it and recompiling everything. But for me, you know, when I'm using some three random libraries, C libraries, recompiling everything is not an option. So I just try to use Valgrind that works out of the box. It emulates entire user land. I don't need to recompile anything. And you know, it's there, it's faster, but you need to recompile everything, and it's a big problem. Just like memcheck, it can actually, you may need to pass some additional option via some environment variable. You might find it in documentation. It can actually track even the variable names, at least if you have debug info. Valgrind can do it as well, but it's not on by default because it causes some additional overhead. But it's a nice feature because it will tell you, you know, the uninitialized memory comes from this variable. Unless in C++, it's some temporary, in which case it cannot say it. Another tool is a thread sanitizer. It's on when you say fsanitize a thread. This is like slowest of them all. They actually make two attempts at writing it at Google. First version was actually Valgrind tool. I don't know what happened to it, but the other one was sanitizer implemented by the compiler. One nice thing is that it has support for atomics, you know, because when you have like data races, which is usually what I have, you have actually two options. You know, you have some shared thing used from multiple threads, and you are accessing it, and you can either use some mutex or something. Or you if it's just some number, some counter, then you are better using some atomic variable. And for example, in C++, we have atomics since C++ 11 in standard library, so that's nice, a thing. But the trouble is, for example, DRDR Helgrind from Valgrind, they kind of ignore it. So they report data races even if you have no data races. But thread sanitizer, you need to recompile it, but it should go away. But I usually still use the RDN Helgrind, and I just ignore those warnings. So that was thread sanitizer. Now I'm gonna summarize a bit, like bad things about Valgrind. First, it's slow. You know, it's terribly slow, and there are two reasons for it. The second reason is the second bullet. The first reason is obviously it's emulating everything, it's decompiling, instrumenting, compiling again. It takes time. Another thing, it serializes thread executions. You know, so even if you have multiple threads, you are not executing them in parallel. You know, they are serialized. As far as I know, there were some attempts at multi-threaded Valgrind, but I don't know how far that went, you know, and whether it's gonna be fixed at some point in the future. As I said, memcheck that does not detect stack and global object overruns. Other sanitizer can do it. There is some experimental tool called SGCheck, like stack global check, that does that. But it uses some terrible magic, and in my opinion, it doesn't work most of the time. So if you need that, if you need to detect overruns for global and stack variables, my advice is use other sanitizer. It obviously cannot detect some undefined behaviors because it does not know as much as the compiler. That's kind of obvious. The compiler is very good at throwing stuff away. Some of that stuff might be preserved in debug info. Valgrind is designed so that it can work without debug info, but it can obviously read debug info, and it's a good idea to use it with debug info because then it can print you nice stack traces, right? But it cannot... some things are simply not preserved, so you need some compiler instrumentation for it, otherwise you are not able to catch it at runtime, you know, no matter what you do. And as I mentioned previously, thanks to all the mumbo jumbo with instrumentation and compilation, the program that is executed is actually different than the one that compiler spits. It's, for example, one illustration is like long double, you know, on Intel. On Intel, you can have float, which is like 32-point floating point variable, double, which is like 64-bit variable, floating point, and you have long double, which is 80-bit. And this is actually most precision you have with 80-bit, with long double. But what Valgrind does, it cannot actually emulate 80-bit floating points because nobody wrote the support. So what Valgrind does is actually, even if you have long doubles and they are executed natively, then if you run your program under Valgrind, it actually takes your 80-bit double, it converts it to 64-bit double, and then it do the calculation on 64-bit double, and then it converts back to long double. So your floating point calculations are silently truncated. You know? This bug was in Valgrind like for 10 years. So far, nobody did anything about it. But most people don't care, but people who do some simulations, they usually complain, you know, that it does not behave under Valgrind the same way as on native machine. Good things about Valgrind, it supports a huge number of architectures. Actually, sanitizers, they exist mostly for Intel or ARM. Usually architectures Google cares about, you know, but Valgrind runs on MIPS, PowerPC, IBM mainframes, and I don't know what, you know. So it supports plenty of POSIX architectures, even 32-bit architectures. For example, some sanitizers don't exist for 32-bit. Works out of the box, no recompilation, it's easy. And it handles entire user land, so there's no need to recompile some obscure libraries you are using. You don't even know you are using them now. So it's very, very easy to use, and that's why I think Valgrind is not obsolete. You know, even if we now have sanitizers which are faster, Valgrind still has some very good use cases. The last slide, I think, is some new thing I learned recently, like a week ago. It's tagging of memory. That's actually some new implementation of address sanitizer that's actually using technique or tagging of memory. So far, it's implemented by guys at Google for Clang and 64-bit ARM only. And it's basically based on the idea that you use some 4-bit or 8-bit number, and you tag both pointer and memory block. And the idea is that the pointer should be tagged with the same like number as the memory block it points to. And if you're doing some things, bad things with pointers, and pointer ends up pointing somewhere else, and you try to dereference the pointer and the tag does not match, then the error is detected. This is actually nice. Not only it saves a lot of, it's faster and less memory intensive than traditional address sanitizer, and it can detect also these use after free far errors. As I mentioned, address sanitizer, even Valgrind does that, puts recently freed block into some quarantine, so it's not reused, you know. But it's eventually reused because you would otherwise run out of memory. But this tagging of memory, this problem is transparent to it. It just works even no matter how far in the future you will have use after free. This will just detect it. Actually, the 4 bits, you have only 16 tags, and they are the best strategy to assign them is at random. But it has, according to guys at Google, it has like 93% chance it detecting errors. You know, it's implementing for 64-bit ARM only because apparently the architecture has some nice feature, some switch in the CPU that says ignore the top byte in a 64-bit address, because actually on 64-bit architectures, the pointer does not use the all the bits, it used just some 40-something bits, and the top is actually unused, so it can be reused for this tagging. There was nice talk at CppCon this year about this, and in a few days it should be it should be on YouTube. So I invite everybody to watch it. You know, it's interesting stuff. Now I have a mandatory thing. This is basically end of my talk, but I should show you this. It's some game, you know, by done by Season Nick. If you want to know more, stop at our kiosk down the stairs. I don't know what it is, you know, you just need to figure out for yourself. And now we have time for questions, if you have any. It can be in Czech, you know, I don't care, you know. The English is just for the video. No questions? Okay, so thank you and have a nice day.